Now that we've laid out the design of the experiment, let's talk about what things we could learn or what questions we could investigate with an experiment of this design. Obviously, if we are looking at two different factors, we would like to know whether each of these factors actually has an effect. So does soap have an effect? Does triclosan have an effect? These two factors are called the main effects because those are the main things that we want to know about. There is, however, also a possibility of there being an interaction between soap and triclosan. For example, perhaps triclosan only reduces the number of bacteria on your hands when it's combined with soap. In fact, it's even possible, although not likely, that triclosan might increase the amount of bacteria on your hands in the absence of soap. So this, in the circumstance like that, it would be a strong interaction between the two things, a strong negative interaction where having more soap makes triclosan work less, better, and vice versa. You could also have an interaction that was a positive interaction. So for example, perhaps when there's no soap, triclosan doesn't work at all. But when there's soap and triclosan, then triclosan works even better than it does when you have just one or the other thing. So we can have both positive and negative interactions, or there could be no relationship between the two things. In the circumstance where you have an interaction term or an interaction effect, then it does not really make sense to ask whether soap or triclosan have an effect by themselves, because if there's an interaction, their status actually depends on the status of the other one. So we can't say that soap always reduces the bacteria more or triclosan always reduces the bacteria more, because it may depend on whether the other factor is present or not. So we have to examine the interaction effect first, and once we know whether it's significant, then we can decide whether we should look at the main effects or not. In the introduction, I mentioned that there are several ways of running this test. Even within R, there are several packages that make it possible for you to do ANOVA. We are sort of taking the simplest approach, which is to use the built-in AOV function to generate an ANOVA object. Using that function, the format for laying out the factors is similar to what we've seen before. We have the dependent variable, or Y, followed by a tilde. Things start getting complicated when we look at the independent variables, or the X's, because instead of having only one X, we actually have several X's, one X for each factor. We put the one factor, then a plus sign, then the other factor. If we have an interaction term that we want to test for, then we add that in as a third factor. The X1 colon X2 is an indication that this is an interaction between X1 and X2. If we translate this into the factors that we actually have in our experiment, then counts are the value of Y. Soap is the first X factor. Triclosan is the second X factor. And then there's a soap triclosan interaction with the data coming from whatever the name of our data frame is. There's actually a shortcut way for writing the model if we want to include the full factorial form of the experiment. In other words, if we want every combination of soap, triclosan, and its interaction, we can use a star. It's possible to have ANOVAs with more than two factors, like a three-factor ANOVA. And in that case, if you put the first factor a star, the second factor a star, the third factor, then it will generate the possible two-factor interactions and the three-factor interaction. So this gets extremely complicated and probably in many cases too complicated to actually understand. But it is possible to set up a model that has three factors in it And by using the stars, you can automatically set up every interaction type.